Yeah, the Corpse Paint Show. Every Sunday we're here live. We're going to give you 90 minutes of live, great, irreverent shit. And also just talk about Satan and talk about movies and talk about metal and talk about Jenny Slash's weekly dose of horror.
Yeah. And I broke my mic.
Your bike?
My mic. What? I don't know. It just came off. I was trying to fix it to where I could talk into it, but it's okay. I'll just hold it. Anyway, happy Sunday, everybody.
Yeah. All right. Look, so we're proud to have Rob and Dave from CYANIDE and Happiness in the studio, live with us here.
Hey, and thanks for having us.
Yeah, and that's Dave over on the right. He's wearing the green, of course, and Rob with the glasses on the left. Thank you, Rob, for being here. Man, we appreciate you guys. And I was in Deep Ellum last night. Do you guys hang out there?
Actually, I was in Deep Ellum on Friday. I went to a stand-up show there, yeah. Yeah, I've been, I go to Deep Ellum a whole bunch. Yeah.
At the comedy club on
Main? Yeah, the comedy club.
Main Street.
Yeah,
cool.
Yeah. Getting down there is a goddamn nightmare, man. I live up in Plano, and it all becomes spaghetti around Deep Ellum when you're trying to drive down there, and it's terrifying.
You have to get there a little early, yeah.
Yeah.
Parking's a nightmare.
But, you know,
sure.
It's a cool zone. It's a Kel zone.
We love and support Deep Ellum, we do. So I was there last night at Reno's, just seeing a whole bunch of metal bands. Hey, Rob.
Hey.
Hey, man.
What's up?
Yeah. I see you over there. As long as
he's hiding.
Yeah, okay. You look good on camera. Look, there we go.
You're right, I do.
And you got the tricolor behind you. I guess we should switch you guys around, right?
I mean, if we need to switch, certainly.
Nah, no
but
problem.
I can be Brazilian for a little while.
You are.
If that works out
you
for
do
me.
Look Brazilian.
Thank you.
Well, with a little more tan.
Is it my butt?
It is.
Yeah.
My butt. We've got a secret camera down here. I mean, she's busy looking at my butt.
Look at her.
We should get a butt cam.
Oh, man. I didn't agree to this.
No, I didn't. Want to come on here without a webcam. So.
Yeah, we have extra small cameras. We do.
Oh, my goodness. Perfect.
Did you guys know today is Johnny Cash's birthday?
I didn't know that.
I didn't know that at all. Hmm.
Johnny Cash and, of course, you know, the man with swagger, the man in black. And you know what happened in South America? Speaking of Brazil, you know what happened in South America today?
No.
A lunar eclipse with a ring of fire.
Whoa.
A ring of fire.
On Johnny Cash's birthday.
Why in Brazil? Did Johnny Cash love Brazil?
It was all of South America, I think.
So it covered a wide base, that ring of fire.
I tried to drive down there, but I it wasn't going to work.
Well, you got stuck at Deep Ellum. That's what happened. You know.
Now, February is Black History Month. We saw a great movie yesterday called Get Out. By Jordan Peele.
I've heard so many good things about
it. Yeah, I haven't had a chance to see it, but I've heard it's amazing.
Yeah.
It is. It's
saw
amazing.
The trailer. Looks incredible.
It is.
I don't even know what it is, to be honest. Is it horror? Is it kind of...
It has
a lot of layers.
And she's the movie expert. This is the movie expert and reviewer.
But
I just wanted to add, this was the most evil movie I've ever seen, and yet Satan was not in it at all.
Well, I mean, Satan isn't like... Satan can be anything. Come on.
Was his spirit
it's
in
evil.
It?
There's evil no, things in it.
I mean, Satan's like $30 million to get him on set, right?
Yeah. He's expensive. He's kind of.
I mean,
hard
he's
to get.
Busy. He's certainly busy at the moment.
Look, our show is growing, and we're working on that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. I just want to remind everybody, I'm in the chat room, so if anybody wants to chat with us,
yeah, throw questions.
Yeah,
at
throw
us.
Questions. Mm. I will ask them. So I'm in there right now.
Oh, cool. Yeah. Oh, I have a fact for you guys. Van Halen's Jump came out on this day in 1984.
Hmm.
No I have nothing kidding. More to say on the matter, but if you want to talk about the Jump video for a little bit, I'm all ears.
32 wow. years. Yeah, that's cool.
I want to talk about how bored Eddie Van Halen is throughout that whole video. He looks like your dad playing guitar extremely well. Just kind of, yeah, whatever. Fingers going everywhere. Spaghetti fingers like Deep Ellum.
Is this the, I don't know if that's a trailer. No, that's something else.
Oh, you pulling out the trailer?
Well,
are we pulling
I think
up Van Halen's Jump?
Of course.
Oh, cool.
Oh,
look how beautiful David Lee Roth is. And correct me if I'm wrong, but he looks exactly like Doc Brown from Back to the Future.
Kind of, yeah.
It does.
In spandex, which is a beautiful image, really.
I would love to see Doc Brown in spandex.
Look, 32 years ago, they thought these moves were cool.
They're way cool. I don't know what you're talking about. They are way cool. Can I throw this rat at you?
Yes.
And miss.
Yes.
It still holds up.
All right. Rat number one.
Hey, we were supposed to start the show with our identities hidden.
Oh, shit. Right. Restart the show. Start over.
Yeah. Let's wipe all of this. Okay.
Wait,
is it too late for this?
Is this some type of satanic mask that I didn't know I was a part of?
That looks like some sort of thing from a kung fu movie.
You guys' masks are cooler than mine.
Yeah, ours aren't very good.
I like you guys' masks better than mine.
And Dave's got the green one.
I'm like a little gremlin. You know,
and look, for some reason, that face does remind me of one of your characters. It does a little.
Sure. I like to draw a lot of strange faces. You're right.
We should do them. That's right.
So these mask makers.
Dave does draw some of the best faces.
That is true.
I will admit.
You know, like I just look in a mirror and kind of go, okay, what am I doing right now?
Do you practice the faces on your own faces?
I will tell you what happens with me like when I'm drawing something is I'll end up pulling the face that I'm drawing at the time to try and feel the tension as I'm drawing.
Do you have a mirror or are you just feeling the muscles in your face?
No, I'm feeling the muscles in my own face. I'm palpating my own face with my own face.
We actually coined the term Dave face to describe any kind of outlandish face. Like when we're making animation, we'll casually say, hey, I think he should have a Dave face in this shot.
If you see any strange faces in any cartoon ever, they took it off me. Right. That includes Ren and Stimpy.
It goes backwards through
it
time.
It goes back all the way.
I get the impression that as you guys were younger, that maybe someone in the family subscribed to the newspaper and you were looking at Far Side every day.
Oh, yeah. I loved Far Side.
We didn't have Far Side overseas. No. We had like kids' comics called The Beano and The Dandy, like English children's comics. And they were pretty ugly. They like to draw cartoon characters pretty ugly over there. So I borrowed a lot of that.
Yeah. You live here now. You're...
At the moment, yeah.
Until Trump gets him.
Yeah, until Trump decides that I'm, you know, a very bad boy and that I need to be kicked out.
You might be one who needs to be.
I don't know.
I don't know too much about your past.
I get a personal call.
Dave, you know. Your comics have gone downhill.
Failing webcomics, CYANIDE Happiness.
Not showing the funniest faces anymore. In fact, it's really sad. I'm going to have to send you back out.
Your fingers are too long.
Hey, yeah,
I can't fix that. Do you want to threaten them off?
Dave, I'm glad you moved over a little because I want you to kind of angle that mic so we can see your face a little better.
She wants to see your face.
Which way do you want to go?
I want to see your face less.
Which way should I
show your face?
The Dave face. Yes. Yes, that's better.
That's the one.
Is that what we're looking for here?
Yeah.
I'm very gummy. That's kind of the weird thing that I've got going on.
Okay, but who came up with the butt shark? The butt shark's my favorite.
Ooh, where did that come from? Oh, that was me, partially.
That was you.
That was me and Chris at a convention.
Yeah, what Rob did was he took a butt and a shark and he slammed it together.
Yeah.
And we kind of worked from that. Yes. Genius. Kind of like a Hadron Collider kind of thing, you know?
A Hadron Collider.
That seriously is one of my favorite ones.
Yeah, me and Chris were at a convention drawing sketches for fans. We were drawing pirates and ninjas and cheese, which are the only three topics people ask you to draw.
Guy with a monkey pirate ninja drawing, putting cheese in his mouth.
Exactly, that's every convention fan. So we were drawing sharks, and we decided to just put a butt on one, and we just laughed about it for the next 3 years and decided to turn it into a character.
Grown men.
There's sharks with butts. There's a butt shark plushie, right?
There is.
Yeah.
We just released it.
Get me that butt
The butt shark plushie.
Plushie.
It's out.
I got to go to the website. And speaking of that, what do you got coming up in March? What is going on here in Dallas?
Well, every year in Dallas for the past, six, 7 years?
This is the seventh one.
We do this thing called the Banana Bar Crawl, where we invite our fans and everyone from the internet who wants to join us to put on banana costumes and then descend on Deep Ellum, previously Uptown, and just get drunk with a bunch of strangers from the internet.
We're doing it in Deep Ellum. Yeah, we're doing it in Deep Ellum this year, but usually we like to go to Uptown and piss off everyone there.
Uptown was funny because everyone in Uptown dresses up and does their makeup for hours to go to Uptown, and then we show up in banana costumes and ruin
them. We kind of cramp their style a little bit.
You belong in Deep Ellum.
Right, Deep Ellum is the place.
Yes.
Deep Ellum, when you go in Deep Ellum dressed as a banana, people are like, oh, hey, yeah, cool. It's nothing weird or out of the ordinary. But if you're in Uptown, they're like, what the
fuck? In Uptown, they're like, what the fuck are all these bananas doing, ruining my date?
They are super happy, too. It's funny, though.
There was some chick. It was like the fourth banana bar crawl or something, and we were in a bar in Uptown. And she goes, why do you talk like that? And I went, oh, because I'm Irish. And she goes, why? It's like, what do you mean? Why am I Irish? Why? I don't know what the answer was for that, but
she didn't ask you why you were dressed like a banana because
no, I guess that was completely normal for her. I don't know what was going on in her brain, but that seems to be the norm for Uptown, kind of these airheaded, besuited people.
And of course, there's the banana conga line.
Yes,
there is.
You have to conga between bars, right?
That's true. Between bar one and two, we always do a conga line.
Yeah, a very obstructionist that goes
in
across
fact,
the road.
Once in Uptown, somebody actually drove through the conga line.
Yeah, my God.
And nobody was hurt, luckily, but they drove right through the bananas.
There was this lady behind the wheel kind of going, sorry.
And then five other bananas ran over and kicked your car a bunch. And I wonder what that looked like from the inside. It must have been terrifying.
Yeah, like sort of like Left 4 Dead or something
that,
like that.
That scene in Children of Men. Yeah.
Now, of course, while we're talking, we want you guys to spot the difference between, you know, Satan is ripping up a good angel there.
Oh, ripping up a good angel.
Yeah, wait, just tearing her guts out.
25 differences.
25 differences.
Does anybody have a pen? Give me that pen.
Yeah, there we go.
Give me that pen.
Okay, both these, so we're taking a look at this.
Both of these pictures gave me a boner, so there's no difference there. That's not one of them.
So, Rob, are you the one who draws all the characters with boners?
I probably do boners the most out of the three of us.
Good question. So I don't know who draws the most boners, but it's probably Rob.
Dave, your boner is bigger.
Thank you.
Yes.
Well, in the arts.
Are we talking about the cartoons or what?
Well, we played Joking Hazard at our last burlesque party.
Yeah.
Yeah, and all my friends were like, this is the best game we've ever played. Awesome. Like, there was one where she didn't even pick a winner. She actually lined them all up perfectly and took a picture and posted it on Facebook. She's like, this goes too well together.
Yeah. Beautiful.
We also played it at Christmas with my family.
What do they think?
Oh, my sister, like, she's 16 and she freaked out in the one where the guy's peeing in the other guy's mouth, that card.
Really?
She was like, oh my God, this is so wrong. But
did
awesome.
You freak out with joy or was it more kind of despair?
She was, like, disturbed. But in a good way.
Okay, so we're doing our jobs then.
We call that. We did it.
The pee in the mouth card is called the trump card.
She loved the game, though. But she was like, is this a thing? So she got a little bit of education.
Good.
It's like, yeah, I'm pretty sure that's a thing, yeah.
Yeah, no, it's definitely a thing.
Are we in agreement that during the Trump years, you're probably going to have a lot of material?
Probably.
Kind of, but we're also too sad to draw, so we have to kind of, it's a balance.
Yeah.
So maybe two bar crawls a year might help. Maybe.
It's going to be not depressing comic week, it's going to be depressing
comic year.
Comic four years.
Right. Yeah.
Because you know what's coming back? That book in front of you is Backward Masking Unmasked.
Oh, I was looking at the Modern Satanic Bible.
Yes.
A bite-sized Satanic Bible.
Yeah, it's a little pint-sized.
Which one are you pointing at?
Kind of penis.
This guy right here? Yeah. Okay.
And you know, this seems to be does it work?
No.
Okay.
Backward Satanic. Oh, cool. Okay.
Because, you know, back when there was early days of vinyl, you know, the accusation was if you played it backwards, of course you'd hear Satan.
Uh-huh.
And I don't know. I'm just thinking here, this might be a good web panel.
Did you know that two of the differences on here, there are two penises on one and there are no penises on the other?
I did not notice that.
Are we still talking about me and Rob?
Yeah. Is it the
boner? There are 25 penis? Differences between my dick and Dave's.
25% difference.
Hey, that's not very much. I don't know.
I don't know. I'll take what I can get, man.
And what I notice on Joking Hazard is the cards that have blood on them have the red frame. Do I have that right?
Oftentimes, the red frames always involve murder or like bad things happening.
Right.
Those are the cards you can't come back from.
But there are a few like where they're just incredibly nice and uplifting. And if you get one of those comics, it's incredibly charming.
Yeah, there's a card where the two characters are sitting on a hill looking at a sunset, and that's one of the funniest cards to me. And you can end any horrible setup with that card.
Yeah, yeah.
That's right, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I know your mom and I just divorced.
I see what you're getting at here. We got a little Pepe down here. We got a couple of Pepe heads. There's one with the Trump hair.
Trump
there's
hair.
One with the... Trump hair. Said Pepe.
I've got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. If he has 2 feet that are painted, does that count as one each? Like, how does that work?
2 feet that are painted. Oh, he does have both feet that are painted.
And the other one they're not. Two. So that's two, right?
I don't know. I think so.
I think I'm going to count that as 10.
It's someone else's fault. Get them on the line.
Proper shout out. This is compliments of, what is it, Decibel Magazine? I think it says at the bottom.
Oh, okay.
Oh, wait. This one's stabbing and this one's not stabby.
Oh.
Did you notice that there's an X-Wing in there?
Did not.
And there's a TIE fighter. Oh, there you go.
And speaking of Satan,
I want to see the backstory of this photo. I want to see what happened to lead to this.
To lead to this. I mean, it looks like the most exciting film ever, really.
I'd watch it.
I just like how this angel has two penises.
Mm-hmm. We do want to encourage
you guys. I'm
enamored
with that, too.
Pointing downward.
How do we know that angels don't?
Exactly.
I thought angels didn't have penises.
I mean, is that really heaven?
Yeah, really.
He's a fake demon. He looks a bit like Eddie Vedder. Eddie Vedder has two dicks, right? I got two dicks.
Dave, we want to hear that again because we love when people make fun of Eddie Vedder.
Yes. Really? Is that an ongoing thing in this show? At home, drawing pictures of my own dick. And there's two. I need two pieces of paper.
That's the best Scott Stapp I've ever heard.
Wow. Yes.
I was there, Scott Stapp.
I'll stop while I'm ahead.
That was Stapp, yeah, for
for sure.
Statsmore kind of murmur.
You should start a Creed cover band.
He starts a, he becomes a parody of Eddie Vedder where his face unfolds into his own head, like he's trying to eat his own eyes.
can we go to Explosism? Explosum?
Keep trying, man.
Yeah, it's whatever it is. It reminds me of an orgasm. That's all I think of.
Yeah. Okay. I think about that every 7 seconds. So
I have one every 7 seconds.
So I love this one here. Ziggy pulled this up earlier, and this is today's, I believe.
Oh yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Yes.
And so if it's today's, does that mean you like whipped it out last night? Or?
I mean, I whip it out every night. I'm sorry. I've got tons of these jokes lined up. So.
That's why we make money off comics.
Yeah.
Jokes.
That's why I make it. Look, there's you.
Okay,
is he right there?
Penny Slice, did you see this?
No.
Okay, we have to start over, Ziggy. I'm sorry, but
we heard we were coming on this radio show, so we made a comic of you setting yourself on fire because that's metal, right?
It is metal.
Anything with fire is hell or metal. Yes. So we enjoy it.
Or a fire hazard. So please.
Yes, I get it.
Man.
And so,
if
the head is shaped differently, and we know that maybe one was Dave's, one was Rob's.
That's some really good corpse paint.
This is by our esteemed colleague Chris Wilson.
That's Chris. Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
I want to know what the guy on the right is trying to accomplish here. Like, he's obviously sacrificing his life to prove to one dude that his religion's not all he thinks.
Well, maybe
not
that
all he thinks it is.
That one dude's his dad.
Maybe.
It's like, God damn it, Dad! I'll show you.
I'll show you. You're wrong.
I like the corpse paint. You should consider that. That's a good design.
Yeah, Chris probably spent a lot of time.
It's very almost like Alice Cooper-y, though, kind of.
Yeah, kind
of. I want to make sure that the camera's seeing all these dead bodies in front of you guys there. And I'm not sure what you did, but there's a lot of carnage.
You mean down here?
Those are baby dolls.
That was me. This one's
particularly disturbing. I mean, what's going on?
They're killing babies over there.
I just get bored. It's a kind of a nervous habit. Whenever I see babies, I just have to put screws in their heads and whatnot.
Did any of you guys watch like WWF in the 90s? This looks like one of the Nasty Boys. Remember that guy? Brian Nasty. Or Knobs and Sags, they were called, or something like that.
Knobs and Sags sounds like an Irish TV show.
Well, it's
Knobs and Sags.
It's also a condition.
Yeah,
it is. And I've got that. Yeah.
An Irish TV show called Knobs and Sags.
Knobs and Sags.
Hey, and you guys have got to contribute, but we want to bring on Hemant Mehta, who writes The Friendly Atheist, and he does an email every day. He's writing articles all the time. He's commenting on fantastic and hilarious things going on daily.
Okay. He writes an email every day? That's one hell of a job.
He writes a blog and then he condenses it for this email. I seem to get three of them a day, and they're all new material.
Okay, so let's do it. Let's talk
to
the
Friendly Atheist.
The Friendly Atheist, that's the name of his book.
Okay, I'm glad there's a Friendly Atheist, because all the atheists I know are assholes. I'm glad there's a good one.
Well, we're friendly too. We are atheists.
Yeah, I'm just joking. I'm an atheist too.
Okay.
Actually, we're here to spread the word of our most high.
and a big Lord shout Jesus. Out to those guys, Asylum. I saw their show last night in Deep Ellum at Reno's. They released their new album called Psalms of Paralysis.
Cool.
Fort Worth metal band.
What kind of music is that? What kind of metal?
Technical Fort Worth, Texas metal.
So like groovy,
super
like
super specific.
Yeah,
I like it.
It's got a lot of variation in some of the songs, and sometimes he sings high pitched, sometimes he has a low growl.
Oh wait, this is the band I missed last night because I was watching people get naked on stage.
Yeah, you are. Yeah.
I really want to compliment the Deathgasm poster. That movie fucking rocks, man.
I haven't seen that.
Indeed. Yeah, and you know you're in the house of the devil.
Right. Absolutely.
Yes, indeed.
This is also a great movie.
Hello.
Hello, Hemant.
Hi. How are you?
Oh, good, man. I'm glad we got you. Are we on just regular phone now? I think we were trying.
We are on regular phone. Can you give me like 5 minutes?
Should we call you back?
Yes, that would be great.
Yes, okay. No problem at all.
He's in the bath.
Yeah. Okay.
Call me back. I've got to get clean and tidy for the radio show.
so maybe that means we can Skype him after 5 minutes.
He was wriggling his toes as you called him in the bed.
He was
really relaxing.
Doing a radio show inside of a giant bathtub would be amazing, though. That would be the best format.
Hang on, can we go into that a little more?
Yeah, it's just all four of us in a bathtub, just talking about politics and stuff.
Is it an empty bathtub?
No.
That's kind of what I was
thinking.
Like, how big's the bathtub?
No,
could it be a jacuzzi?
When you say all four, you mean us four, and we'd put Ziggy in there too, of course.
Yeah, we need Ziggy in.
Yeah, definitely. We need him in. Yeah. We need to control all the reverb.
I'm worried about the electronics getting wet.
Yeah, I think that would be like a health and safety thing.
Well, that's why I was saying no water. Just can all we of just us waterproof? Naked in an empty bathtub.
But I think it would make it challenging. Earth. We all eat a whole bunch of spicy food right before this show.
Oh, man, it's next level.
I don't know.
What are you trying to get out of that,
then
man?
Then we just blame each other for the bubbles.
No. Yeah, I'm trying to get a jacuzzi.
Him.
Yeah.
I see. So, I see.
Okay. I think I'd rather have jets.
I was still thinking about the empty bathtub, so I thought you meant we were going to fill it up.
Too much reverb wouldn't work.
Well, tell us a little more about the comedy club. Is that what it's called on Main Street in Deep Ellum?
The Comedy House.
Yeah, they do a lot of improv down there and stuff. And, you know, they have improv classes. So we went to see the stage twos where they're still kind of learning the ropes and stuff.
In fact,
like that. And
it's fun fact, the merchandise director of our company, of Explosum, does the improv classes. He teaches improv classes at Dallas Comedy House.
Very cool.
So it's way cool.
Yeah. What's her name?
Christy Wallace.
Christy, all right. I may have met her. Mm. I mean, we're in Deep Ellum all the time.
Oh, yeah.
And we do a monthly show at Wit's End, a burlesque slash sideshow.
Oh, what's it called?
Deadly Sins Burlesque and Sideshow.
I think I've actually looked that up before. That was my Valentine's Day plan.
By yourself?
Yeah.
It would have been a good Valentine's Day plan.
We had a wild Valentine's Day show.
Oh, I bet.
And I mean, there's fake blood, and there's barbed wire, and there's a bed of machetes. And
sounds like a pretty normal Valentine's Day to me.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Yeah. And I was in a body bag.
Okay.
And then someone got on top of her.
I have to play dead. Me and my friend have this routine where I'm the dead body, and they carry me through the crowd in the body bag, and they lay me on the stage.
Okay.
And then she comes like on stage and like unzips the body bag and like does her little burlesque routine on top of me. Like it's totally like a necrophilia routine. And the whole time I have to pretend to be dead. So she like pokes me in like the armpit.
So who's coming in and watching that? Face. I want to know who the your average Joe is.
It's
coming
a
in to watch
really
that
popular routine, actually. Yeah, it's like highly requested.
A lot of
Deep Ellum.
A lot of people from all over the world, because there seems to be a lot of tourists down there. But a lot of Deep Ellum regulars and a lot of guys who just like getting drunk and watching half naked women.
Hey, that's me.
Yes.
Yeah. But we have sideshow and we have magic. And
magic.
We have a magician.
Magic Gathering.
Yeah, not a Magic Gathering.
I hope it's Magic the Gathering. I really want to play Magic the Gathering.
I would watch half naked girls play Magic the Gathering on the stage.
There's a market for that.
Yeah. I would watch Rob watching naked chicks.
And just for clarification, this is not traditional burlesque. Mm-hmm. This is neo, edgy, very dangerous, bloody burlesque.
But it's a lot of fun.
I was about to say, it's not your mama's burlesque.
Exactly. It's not your daddy's, right? So.
And he hosted as Satan on stilts.
Yeah, I wear
he's
stilts.
A giant Satan.
And dress up as a big demon.
Okay.
As the MC.
Man, do you have that costume in here? I'd love to see that.
I don't, man. We'll have you guys back.
Okay, sure.
Oh, he's got a photo. And also, we want to pull up Beer Run maybe here in a few minutes.
Ooh, Beer Run.
Please. Yeah.
Weed Run, too.
Oh, really? Man, no one's ever said they liked Weed Run before. You're the first one.
I think Weed Run's funny. It's poorly edited. It's great.
Yeah. It's kind of a joke on the audience, but a lot of people were like, oh, wait, thanks for wasting
minutes
of my life.
I like the part whenever he gets in the car like slow-mo and he's just freaking the fuck out.
Yeah, it was
funny, guys,
man.
Can you see that one? So that's me on the left, and then there's the baby doll, and actually that guy is a necro butcher from the band Mayhem.
Cool. Oh, really?
Yes, indeed.
Wow. Yeah. That's fucking red.
Yeah.
You're like 20, 30 feet tall
and
there.
And yes, indeed. And that's Vern Troyer at the bottom.
Holding
a
baby.
Motley Crue.
So, yeah.
Cool, man.
Yeah, that's in Deep Ellum.
Sweet.
We have a ton of fun. So Beer Run is, of course, an old classic favorite, and if you don't mind... I know you guys watch it a million times.
Yeah.
But
please.
Heck, let's put it on. And I do want to say Weed Run is better than the Charlie Brown special.
Oh well, definitely.
Absolutely.
I mean,
yeah. The editing is a lot better.
Definitely.
Thank you. Yes.
Hey, Margarita. This party's crazy.
Whoa!
It's a shame we got it. It's a shame we're out of booze, though.
Wait.
No. I better wrap this up and get these people out of here.
Wait, dude. I could get more potty for the booze.
No way. No way.
I'm not.
You're more drunk than I am.
I'm not that drunk. We're pooping on the party.
I really don't think you should be doing this, man.
You're not my babysitter. I go to the liquor store down the street.
All right, if you insist. Wait. You pick up some ice while you're out? Thanks, dude.
Give me your purse, you dumb bitch!
Oh, God.
Thanks! And then she's all like, I don't even eat pasta, so I'm like...
I made it!
Oh, shit! I forgot the ice!
When Janie Slash first showed that to me a while back, I think we just couldn't stop laughing for quite a while.
I watched it at work, like, repeatedly.
Nice.
All the time.
We got to just tell you
guys. Every time.
It does.
Yeah, it does.
You catch more, and there's a poster in the background. You're trying to figure out what's the meaning there. And look, it helps everyone who works in an office or in a cubicle get through the day. So we appreciate you guys.
Yeah. Sure. Yeah. I do that and read all the comics, and then I watch the shorts in the show.
Cool. Oh, well, thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Beer Run was actually one of the very first shorts we made back the first time Dave came to the country in 2010.
Yeah. It's kind of like our Smells Like Teen Spirit, where it's like, oh, you're the guys that did that one. It's like, yeah, that's us.
It's still probably our most popular. It was all downhill.
No.
Whatever. No. It's not true.
I do like the ones where you make fun of ultra religious people or the one that
we got
was,
a few of those.
Yes. The one that was.
I really appreciated the Cruciflex, which then you changed to like what was the Vegaflex or something like that.
Yeah, I made the Cruciflex comic where the crucifix is like as seen on TV workout product. Facebook, enough people reported it that Facebook deleted it and banned me for 24 hours. So I posted it back up a second time, except I replaced the cross with a cross made of asparagus so that nobody would get offended. And I still got banned again.
Why asparagus?
I don't know. I figured
why not?
It was different enough from.
Well, you have to keep it fresh, you know?
You do.
That wasn't a joke. That wasn't even a joke.
Well,
that was totally a joke.
I think he's abusing vegetables, frankly.
I mean,
I don't understand why that one got banned. Was Facebook just like, whatever, you tried to get by with it, that's enough, and took it off too? That's so stupid.
If you guys don't mind, we'll try and get Hemant back on.
Please.
To talk about all the craziness in the world right now. And
oh, man.
From the Friendly Atheist. Intelligent guy. He's went to DePaul in Chicago, got his master's degree. He used to be a school teacher, and then he just left because he saw the net as just so rich and rewarding.
Well, I guess he's right. I don't, the net is a hive of scum and villainy.
Hey.
Hemant, how are you?
I'm good. How are you guys?
Man, it's great to talk to you. And have we got to keep it on telephone, right?
Unfortunately, we do. I'm not in my house right now.
Okay, no problem. We appreciate your time. And, you know, I wanted to pull up a favorite that we've got here.
Yeah.
And let's just talk about it. Everything you send on the Pathos Friendly Atheist email just cracks me up so much. And we've got two web comics in the studio here, Rob and Dave from Cyanide and Happiness.
Hi.
I love them, by the way. I was so excited they were on here. Yeah. I love Cyanide and Happiness.
Thank you. Hey, how's it going, man? Oh, my wife just informed me that she's a big fan of you, so.
That is awesome.
Awesome.
I read the comic every day, and it makes me laugh, and then I feel bad about myself.
That's the plan. That's the plan.
So this one here, and first off, am I pronouncing your name correctly?
Hemant.
Hemant. Okay, yep. Hemant.
Uh-huh.
And it's the CPAC panel, and is this real? They have a panel that if heaven has a gate, a wall, and extreme vetting, why can't America?
That is the name of the panel.
Wow.
I actually watched the panel. They put it up online, And unfortunately, they never actually talked about heaven. They were just talking about what we could do to keep immigrants out of the country, which is a little disappointing. But that title is just hilarious because heaven's process for letting people in is probably worse than anything. It's like if you just say you're a believer in Jesus, they technically have to let you in. Doesn't matter how bad you are. Doesn't matter how many criminal acts you've done. So it seems like the wrong metaphor for them to... Or the wrong analogy to use there.
Well, it's kind of vague depending on who you ask or what religion you're talking to. So it's kind of like Trump's America in that he's kept everything intentionally vague so that when you actually get to the airport, they can tell you to fuck off for any reason, really.
People.
We talked about a movie on a show a week or two ago called Hellbound.
Okay.
I didn't know if you're familiar with it, Heman. And
I'm not sure.
It's a cool documentary, and basically their point is that religious leaders seem to be embracing extreme hatred because their argument is that's what God did since he excludes so many people from heaven. And I don't know. It was a profound message presented in a pretty humorous way and a cool documentary. But anyways.
It's weird because one of the things I'm seeing is that, there are some Christian leaders who are saying those sorts of things, dividing people up, kind of making it an us versus them sort of thing. But,
yes.
I mean, I will say, to their credit, there are also a lot of Christian leaders who are going out of their way to make sure, like, they are providing homes for illegal immigrants who are afraid they're going to get deported.
Mm-hmm.
They're kind of going against the grain of what this administration is doing.
Yep.
And more power to them. I love the fact that they're doing that. But it seems like one of those divides that for all this talk about what would Jesus do, this idea that embracing whatever Donald Trump's administration is pushing, that seems to go against all the good things Christians have always told us. You know, if you want to act like Jesus, you should do this and this and this. None of those things are what Donald Trump is promoting.
Very good point, and you seem to point that out regularly. And this, you know, your blog, which is the email, is always packed with good information. So. Man, I just hope we can remain friends and perhaps even just work together. I just love what you do and all the information you send out. And all of it is real. You provide a link to to some outrageous statement a politician or someone has made against science or the like, and it just has me on the floor rolling until you realize
this is real.
I would be very interested to see what most of the Christian far right think of Steve Bannon, a guy quoted as saying, "Darkness is good. Satan, Darth Vader, that's power." Guy is in the upper echelons of government.
Everything
right now.
I can see is that the loudest Christian leaders, the ones who tend to get all the headlines, they are not saying anything critical of people like Bannon, of anyone in the Trump administration, to me, it just seems like bad strategy. I mean, just think of what would happen if a Christian leader like Franklin Graham, a far-right Christian leader, said something like, "This is not what Jesus told us to do. You know, I'm a Republican, but the way this administration is functioning goes against everything I was taught growing up in my church." Just something along those lines would make such a huge difference, and you will never see anyone like him doing that.
Right.
They're just embracing everything this administration is doing, and they don't care about the religious aspect of it, which just goes to show this was never about promoting Christianity for them. It was always about politics. It was always about pushing a political agenda, which is the thing liberals always accuse them of doing, and they would get mad about it. But I don't know what shows that as strongly as what they're doing right now. This has nothing to do with the Bible. This has everything to do with just
politics.
Make sure we can get our political agenda passed. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you're so right. And, hey, then you had another recent one today of a legislator. Was it a state legislator who was making this long, really a sermon in her car? And it's linked to her Facebook. She's a state rep or a national rep and clearly endorsing straightforward endorsing a religion. That was crazy. But would you tell me a little more? Yeah, it's that one right there. Would you tell me a little more about the story of conversion therapy? Where what was the end result of that story?
I'm not sure which specific story you're asking about, but I mean, there are Christians, including Mike Pence, the vice president, at one time, who said, if you are gay, we will help you stop being gay, and we'll put you through therapy sessions to try to, like, rid you of the gay.
Pray the gay
away or something. As if that's the thing you could do. And it was really bad. It got to the point where they were even recommending, like, shock therapy, like electrical currents, in order to rid you of the gay, which tells you that they don't have any clue what they're actually upset about. They don't understand how sexual orientation works, but they think they have a cure for it.
So we've got a march on science coming up, right? We all need to just send money or at least attend the event or I don't know or something. But maybe these little steps will open some people's eyes in this country.
Yeah, I mean, it's one of those things. There seems to be a new protest every week. If there's one in favor of science, more power to them. I don't think I'm making any plans to go to Washington or anything, but, man, if people can raise people's awareness of the fact that this is an entire Republican-led Congress that really doesn't care about facts or reason or evidence, maybe that'll help in 2018 when the next midterms are around.
Yeah, that's right. Well, what are some of the other standout stories that you've had fairly recently, or maybe even not recently, that I don't know, just still make you chuckle?
You know what's sad? There are stories that are happening all the time now where if I saw that maybe a few years ago, I'd be like, this is really unusual. And you get these stories like once a week. Stories like a Florida state representative going on Facebook Live, like you mentioned, and ranting against witches who want to take down Donald Trump or something. Like, that's so bizarre, and it's an elected official doing that you would think, this doesn't happen all the time. What's really sad is that this thing happens, like, on a daily basis, and it goes unreported in most places because there's so much bigger shit going on in the country.
Yeah.
So I try to focus my website on kind of the things that are not going reported everywhere else.
Good.
To make sure they get some sort of outlet. But these stories come all the time. Like, it's a Sunday. It's a Sunday and these stories are coming out. Like, give me a break for like a day or two, but there is none.
That's why we have our show on Sunday. We want to be a church for the unchurched.
Right.
This is our gathering of the friendly non-believers, you know.
Yeah.
But, you know, and then another one we pointed out a couple of shows back is that some religious nut said if you oppose Trump, you're in the grips of Satan or something similar to that. And I thought, well, you know, that's at least 150 million people in this country alone. So, I mean, Satan has got to be pretty powerful. He's controlling that many people.
Like Steve Bannon said, man, you know, that's power. It's all feeling a bit Bioshock Infinite these days, isn't it? If you've ever played that.
Yeah.
Like, if you want to walk through America right now, just play Bioshock Infinite.
It's the exact same policies you're seeing come out of the Trump administration now. Republicans would be the ones fighting against it, saying, how dare you treat refugees this way? That goes against our morals and ethics. And, you know, if issue was on the other foot, they'd be whining. But right now, it's their guy in charge, so they're supporting him in everything he does, no matter how bad it gets.
Right. Yeah, that's a great
tribalism.
Point.
Yeah, that's
essentially
a great
what it
point.
Is.
Yep.
Yeah.
But I've never heard
that's one thing I have to say. The one thing I do appreciate about, quote unquote, my tribe is that we're not afraid to call out our own people if they screw up or they're doing something we don't like. Maybe that's not good for strategic purposes, but I feel like all the liberal publications I read have no problem saying, here's something a liberal did wrong, but I feel like I'm not seeing that on the other side.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And you know, if you're atheist or you're atheistic Satanist, also, we're going to call you out if you're trying to recruit too hard. We don't like that. You know?
Yeah.
We don't need more in our group. You know, we're not like...
And we don't need to... The thing is, we don't need to recruit. I mean, one, we don't win anything for recruiting you. It's not like we're getting money for it. But two, I mean, if you read my website at least, I spend very little time trying to tell anyone why they should be atheists.
Sure.
It's very much, here's what religion led people to do, and it's crazy. Mm-hmm. I don't see how you could read these stories day in and day out and then still walk around saying faith is a virtue, you know?
Yeah. So it's a sad day, I guess, because Family Christian or Christian Family, what's it called? Family Christian bookstores closed down.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
You wrote the very insightful piece on the fact that they blamed it on, I don't know, they had too many books on the shelf, too many offerings.
Yeah. I mean, look, it's a bookstore, that's primarily a bookstore, and of course, like Borders, they're going to go out of business. It's hard to be a bookstore these days, so I get why the company got out of business. But one conservative writer said something like, no, they didn't go out of business because of economic forces. They went out of business because they were selling books that didn't portray a single conservative interpretation of the Bible. So, like they were selling self-help books by celebrity pastors, by feminist Christians who were saying the Bible says you're not supposed to treat women in a particular way, which is what the stereotypes say.
Yeah.
How dare they sell those books? And by, you know, apparently by offering more material to a broader customer base, that hurt them. Apparently, if you only sell, like, one book, you would have been successful.
So, heaven forbid there's another perspective on something, and a bookstore carries it, you know?
Exactly.
It's just funny. All of them are hilarious. And, look, I just think that there's not been as much talk about, I don't know, wizards and demons and Satan and all of that in the news. So in a way, I'm kind of excited about that because we could always twist it and use it on this show somehow. So I don't know. And it probably is going to lead to my prediction, a lot of good underground hardcore music maybe will reemerge and edgy movies, you know, about the fear, kind of the fear a lot of people live in this country now.
I just hope the witches come out and vote next time instead of just casting spells.
Yes. Well, that's the thing, right? We outnumber the other side, but we're lazy as hell on election day.
That's true.
So what does it take? I mean, if all the stuff that's going on right now doesn't encourage people to get out and vote, I don't know what will. So I hope people can get their act together. And I hope all this energy and the protests and everything, don't forget all that by the time 2018 comes around.
Yeah.
And by the way, I should also mention, it's not too late to even get on the ballot. I mean, this is one thing that constantly frustrates me. It's that a lot of the articles I'm posting about include state officials, city council members who are just batshit crazy. And you're like, how the hell did they get elected to these positions in the first place? And it's because they were smart enough to run.
Yep.
And the people like the scientists, the rational thinking people, usually feel like, I don't want to run. I have better things to do with my time. And then, of course, these other people win, and things go haywire.
Yeah. Yeah, Pete Sessions, the representative of the North Dallas
Scientist
district, he ran without
a Democratic.
They said
they were
going
to run for things, but we need more people to run who are sensible.
Is Sessions the one? Go ahead.
Pete Sessions ran completely unopposed by any Democrat. They didn't even nominate
Just because of gerrymandering?
No, they didn't actually run anybody. Nobody ran against him in his last election.
Wow. Because of that, he's supposed to be retiring after this term, and so they're thinking that his son is going to run. Mm-hmm. And so a Democrat has already filed to run, and they were on one of our shows last week.
Cool.
Good. And I should mention that this past election, there were a lot of atheists who ran for state representative or state senate and even U.S. representative or senate. I will say most of them lost, but not all of them did. I mean, some of them won, and they won in places like Arizona. They won in places you might not necessarily expect them to win, and they were open about their atheism. Doesn't mean you agree with all their positions, but it's like, oh, wow, you used to think that being an atheist would be the biggest liability, and somehow it didn't hurt them. They had enough on their resume that people were willing to say, you know what, I may not agree with you on religion, but I think you're good in terms of a representative for me. The more of us who run, the better off we're going to be.
So maybe we turned a corner, and sometimes you don't realize you turned the corner until a year later, you know? So maybe we have.
Yeah.
Very cool. And, you know, all politics is local. And so what affects you and your community the most is school board, community, you know, community college board, a local city council.
Right.
That's what affects you the most. And you're right. It doesn't take many votes for anyone who chooses to run to then get in that office.
Yep.
So
you'd be surprised at how few people vote seem to, or in local elections anyway. It doesn't seem to.
Hardly anyone votes in local elections. Everyone thinks the president's the only important person to vote for.
Yeah, no. You got to vote in your local, the school board elections, the city council elections, because people win with a margin of like 10 votes.
Right. Yep. And I've read about...
Like, you couldn't... People actually cared.
Mm-hmm. I've read about whole districts of Dallas kind of being won, and there were like 400 votes cast in that entire district. And I'm talking about a pretty large area, and people just don't pay attention, really.
Yeah.
I don't
know. Yep. And by the way, conservatives know that, and that's why they get their people to run in those elections.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, good point. Well, we really appreciate you, and, you know, just keep putting out the information. I think it is getting out there. So for someone who's uninitiated, how do they find you?
Sure. The easiest way is friendlyatheist.com.
Okay.
That'll direct you to the website. And from there, you can get to Facebook, Twitter, all that good stuff.
All right, good. And then it can join the email mailing list there, right?
Yes. Okay. There's a way to get an email link. That way you can just get an email summary of all the big stories from the day. That way you only have to look once instead of like a million times. And that email will either make you laugh or make you cry, depending on what happened.
Yeah. And, you know, on this show as well, we promote extreme metal, and I call it sinister metal. And that means black metal, death metal, all forms of aggressive metal. And, you know, I think that we need to just enjoy it now in case there's some sort of, like, clampdown against artistic expression of either webcomics or extreme metalheads, you know.
Yeah, man, they're all in the same bed, you know.
Kind of.
So, but you know, let's hope it does not come to that. We're going to keep metal underground, and certain webcomics underground, maybe. You know.
Sure. Why not?
It's the only place we're safe.
Yeah, that's bunker. Right. That's what we need.
You know, and it's funny you mentioned that. I used to make fun. I used to make fun of people who were building bunkers, you know, and these bunker shows and all that. And now I'm thinking, you know,
right?
They were on to something. They had a point.
It's pretty weird that tinfoil hats seem incredibly fashionable all of a sudden, and that we should all start wearing them.
So, and I need radiation protection. We actually do have a few gas masks in the house.
We do have a couple of gas masks.
We do.
I think we're pretty well prepared for the apocalypse in our house.
But she's been using them for performance art. But we really need to figure out how they actually work.
Oh, okay. Are they like old war ones, like from World War II? Or are they like modern?
We have a more modern one and an old one.
Cool. So I guess you have to fight over who gets the modern one.
Yeah, I get the modern one.
Yeah, that's right.
That's mine.
We do. All right, so what else is on your mind, man? I mean, anything else breaking that you can share, or news coming up, or I don't know, anything that just has kind of struck your fancy?
I'm pretty sure things are going to get worse. I'm very curious with the Oscars coming up shortly. I wonder if politics will take a front seat and religion for once will take a back seat. Maybe fewer of the candidates will thank God for their win and spend their time actually talking about Trump or something. Yeah. That would be interesting.
Yeah. Yeah. And, you know, look, I hate to bring up a negative, sad story, but is it this tone that has been set in the White House that has led to this shooting in Kansas City we heard the supposed comments the guy made. You know, I don't think he realizes that it's just sad. The tone has been set, and a lot of people just take that and think that they're being a patriot by shooting someone with a different color skin.
Well, you know, it's been...
Yeah, and as an Indian guy myself, it's like...
Yes.
Not that it would have been okay if they were Muslim. I'm like, you're not even going after the wrong guys. It's ignorance on top of this stupid vigilantism. And it's frustrating because most of the Indians I know anyway... we're not immigrants. We've been here our entire lives. It's our parents who came here. So it's just a sad story in so many ways. Yes, and of course, Trump is just deflecting from there by, you know, tweeting about the New York Times or whatever it is, so people don't talk about
I believe, was it Spicer that said, it's too early to tell what his motives were, when, you know, we have the quotes from him explaining exactly what his motives are.
As if they take their sweet time on accusing anyone else of doing anything.
Yeah. Exactly. They've washed themselves of all responsibility.
Is another good idea that we should encourage our friends to subscribe to the New York Times and other news outlets because they need our support now more than ever?
Oh, yeah. I mean, any good national paper and your local paper, too, for what it's worth, you should absolutely support it. Because, you guys mentioned earlier, all politics is local. There are good people who are going to be covering Trump and everything he does. What you guys need to be aware of, though, is what's happening at the city council level, what's happening in your state house, state government, because I think if you ask most people, they have no idea who their representatives are at the state level.
Sure.
And it's the local reporters who cover that stuff, and they're the ones who are being let go. So, support a local paper to any of the listeners.
The first sign, in my view, the first sign of fascism is clamp down on the media. Mm-hmm. Shut the media up. And it seems like that's what's happening.
It's exactly what's happening.
Very much so. Yeah. I was reading something about how we won't really know we're in a fascist state until we look at it retrospectively.
Yes.
We don't know. There's not going to be a line, where it's like, we're in a fascist state now. It's not like seeing the rain come.
Yeah.
We're already going to be in it.
And so in 6 months or 6 years, we might be looking back to this day and asking ourselves, why didn't we do more?
Mm-hmm. Certainly.
Yeah.
All right, man.
Yep.
Happy Johnny Cash birthday.
You too. Thanks for having me, guys.
And you're very welcome. Can we do it again soon?
I would love to. Thank you.
Great to talk to you, man. Yeah.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks, man. Bye, all.
All right, bye.
Okay,
bye. That guy's a great guy.
Yeah. Cool.
Yeah.
I'm glad you got. Thank you for participating.
I just want to point out that I found 30.
30. It says there was 25.
30.
Yeah, this is a lie. This is
fake news.
Fake news.
I don't know if they're accurate, but I think I found 30.
we're going to have next week on, they're playing a gig. This is a band called Lordy. They dress up as...
I was about to say, is that Lordy?
Yes,
Lordy.
Yeah.
Yeah, Lordy will be here Saturday at Trees.
They're going to be at Trees on Saturday.
Hmm. Sweet.
And they invited me backstage to do a discussion with them and bring the camera and all that.
Yeah.
So.
I won't be there Saturday.
Might want you there. It's Saturday night.
Saturday night.
March 5th.
Where's the drummer? Because I remember watching him on a... they won a thing called the Eurovision Song Contest. I don't know if you know about that over in Europe, where every country gets to submit a song.
Yes.
And the drummer looks exactly like... He looked exactly like Predator at the time. And it was like, is that fucking Predator on the drums? That's badass.
Well, here's what Lordy does. They actually change and upgrade their costume every year.
Okay.
And this guy, the head guy, it's Mr. Lordy. No, I'm sorry. Mr. Lordy is what he goes by.
Please call me Lordy.
Mr. Lordy.
So I had the pleasure of talking to him by phone last week, and he said, yeah, definitely, this is going to be great. You got to come to the show, and we're helping get the word out. But he's the costume designer as well, and he makes all the crazy stuff. So, next week, Saturday, if you guys have nothing to do, you might want to check out a Lordy show.
Shit, yeah.
There's also a Marvel versus DC burlesque show at Viva's.
Uh-oh.
I will not be at Lordy. I'll be Spider-Man that night.
Is it the same time? We have to choose?
Yeah.
I would discover his identity.
Actually, it's like right before. It starts at 9.
But tell us what Spider-Man does in your routine.
It's a secret. You have to come see it.
Oh,
climbs the silks.
Yeah.
Spider-Man plays dead in a body bag. It's the same routine.
Spider-Man plays dead in a body bag.
You have to catch him in a giant glass plays dead. You have to put him outside.
No, it's my Spider-Man routine. It's an aerial silks routine.
Cool. So as a spider, she's climbing up the aerial silks.
Badass.
Yeah, it is.
I don't do it like this, though. I don't know how you could climb like... That's not a thing. You can't do that.
That's how I dance.
Are there any others?
That is how he dances. It's really bad. I run away from him, pretend like I don't know him when he wants to dance with me.
So we got invited to a Sweet 16 party on Friday night.
Someone's 16th birthday?
Yeah.
Okay.
It was my friend's daughter.
Yeah.
So we drove to East Texas and had a great time with all these East Texans and
he kept trying to pull me on the dance floor, and I ran away, and I saw him like right at the tail end of the train.
Come on, ride the train.
No, don't
ride
sing it.
Up.
Don't sing it.
Yeah,
don't
that
sing
one.
It.
Where
and
was
I was
it?
Like, I'm so glad I'm not in that train. Tyler.
Tyler.
We were,
Tyler.
We were in Longview the day before doing a Mardi Gras party.
Ooh.
Yeah.
And
very cool.
Dave, if you've not been to East Texas, it's a little different than Dallas.
I've been to East Texas.
All right. There you go.
I've been to Kenton, and a friend of ours has a lake house out there in buttfuck nowhere.
Yeah, it's hard to find beer out there. That's the only thing I know about it.
You have to take beer with you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You really do. It's completely dry out there, but they have a nice lake that you can swim around in.
The lake's pretty dry these days, too.
So yeah.
You can't drink it much. Well, I think
that's why it's drying out. We've been drinking it the whole time.
I like going to Fredericksburg because they let you drink outside.
I love Fredericksburg. Yeah. It's my favorite place in
Texas.
Have
you been to their metal bar?
No.
They have a metal bar there. It's like this tiny...
Fredericksburg? I've never
been
there.
Yeah, it's called like Der Dywall.
Huh. It's run by a German couple.
Yeah, it's awesome.
Sweet.
It's a metal bar.
They have metal shows there. It's tiny, but they like cram the band in the corner, like where they have couches, and they're like, yeah, metal. It's awesome. Fucking awesome.
Did they play like Creator and Rammstein and all that sort of stuff?
Yeah, they do.
Yes.
They do.
Sweet.
Yeah, we had an Iron Maiden beer.
We bought Iron Maiden beer.
What was it called?
I can't remember. It's on the tip of my tongue. But I can't remember what it's called.
Yeah. Maiden something.
Anyway, we had Iron Maiden beer there.
So the other news is Annabelle. The actual doll?
Mm-hmm. You mean like the movie?
No, Annabelle at the Occult Museum.
Oh.
Yeah, and they moved her into a new case. So they
the
like
actual face- she moved herself.
No, they Facebook Live the whole thing. Hmm. Like you could watch it on Facebook Live. Like all these people went psycho and tuned into it, and all they did was like say a blessing and like dip their hands in holy water and like carry her to a new.
They could have really fucked with people by putting all these digital graphics over it, so you get your weird that would experience.
Have been amazing. If it like started attacking him and he's like,
that'd be awesome. Help me!
I could never move the doll because I'd be like, it's on my face, get it off! Why are you guys killing me? And they'd be like, kidding.
No, but the doll does something really domestic. Like, it makes you a really nice deli sandwich. You know? Yes. It's like, so spooky. Don't eat it. Whatever you do, don't eat
don't
it.
Don't eat it.
I would never put her back in the box if she made delicious sandwiches. Which like, you can stay out. Which just be evil.
Kind of reminds me of Get Out, because the family, at first, you're drawn in because the white family is so friendly.
No, they were weird.
To the black
boyfriend. You know there's something not right.
It's a little bit spooky. It's like, but you're too nice.
The whole movie has this like
cool movie.
Building of dread. It starts out like, you know, okay, it starts out not too bad. And then like, you're like, these people are off. Okay, this shit's kind of weird. Okay, this shit's really weird. And then you're like, what the fuck?
Yeah.
No offense, but that's kind of how I feel about most of rural Texas.
Yeah.
As an Irish dude.
Yeah.
In Texas.
Yeah. That's what this. It was a great movie, though. I highly recommend it.
Awesome.
If we go to I don't know Ulster or Dublin, I don't know somewhere. Is there, you know, would we see burlesque right now or is it, you know, what is in the pubs? It's live music and it's a lot of drinking. And maybe some magic shows.
Magic shows. I'm sure there's plenty of weird spots in like Dublin. Yeah, cool. I don't know. It seems like Ireland is very repressed in terms of its sexuality.
Oh, it is?
None of us know how to talk to women whatsoever. So
Catholic. Very Catholic.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, the Protestants are even worse. We don't know how to talk to women whatsoever. But you probably find some weird shit in Dublin, man, if that's what you want. Belfast, I can't think of anything at the top of my head right now. They're very excited because they just got their first Victoria's Secret.
Ooh.
Baby steps.
So, you know, they're all rubbing their hands at that. And there might even be, like, protests from local groups or something like that. Who knows? But, yeah.
Because the mannequins are scantily clad.
Indeed.
Yeah. I know there is one burlesque performer who travels here from Ireland.
Oh, cool.
Her name is Bella Agogo.
And she probably gets more Agogo.
That's her name. Yeah, she's a burlesque performer. She comes down here, like, once a year to tour.
She probably gets
I've
more
never actually
gigs
met her, but I've seen her. Yeah, she gets a lot of gigs.
Here?
Cool. Yeah, her, and then there's another girl, I believe, from Australia. Hmm. She does fire assholes. She lights her assholes.
Fire what?
Fire. Assholes?
Oh, I thought you said something else.
No, assholes.
I was like, my God. Is this like
not a fire asshole.
Yeah.
It's like that Johnny Cash song.
No, it's like tassels, but for your ass, and she lights them on fire and then spends them.
What do you mean, like, with her like ass. Tassels on your ass, like...
Yeah.
Like,
as if you had like nipples and then you put you on your ass and then you put them
ass.
On your ass.
So it looks like, so it looks like your butt just graduated.
And you do this little motion with your butt and
that
it
sounds
makes
like,
you spin.
Like if you
want to,
that's awesome. If you want to dress your butt up like for Christmas, that sounds like the first thing
I know
do.
A lot of people who can help you.
Yeah, you'd want some green and red.
Would you put a star in there?
A star?
I'd put
maybe a little angel. I don't know.
Like an angel popping out.
I would put this mask on my butt.
Oh, yeah?
Nobody would mess with me.
Rob, you can choose any weird fact interesting fact out of there you'd like and read about it. I just want to say, just real quick, and hopefully people can see this, if you would be interested in sponsoring our show, Hit me up, of course, Facebook, and then the email is stiltdemon. Let's see, do I have that
yeah,
right?
Yeah, sponsor us so we can get better signs.
stilldemon@gmail.com. So we'd love to talk to anyone who's maybe interested
in
sponsoring.
He uses them on the back of past show flyers.
Yeah. Oh, heck yeah. The freak show mask.
Well, you know, DIY, man. Yeah.
So, yeah.
Rob, where's this weird fact? You're taking your time.
It's pretty cool. It's all these facts are so weird. I don't know how to pick the
weirdest
one.
Did you find the morbid ones, though?
Which one are the morbid ones?
I don't know.
Morbid facts.
It's weird
morbid
stats and morbid facts.
Cool. Yeah, they're all kind of movie related. This is cool. All right, let me pick one.
And Dave, you know, while he's doing that, if you got a pen nearby and just want to, I don't know, whip out a caricature of the studio or something, I don't care.
I would love to.
I like how you keep asking Dave to whip things out.
I know. I wasn't even going to mention it again. But third time's the charm, let me tell you. I whip it out in front of a mirror and say my name three times.
Yeah.
So, I don't know where I was going
with
it.
Whip it out.
Okay, he's got the camera under the table. So there you go. It's
what,
under
what,
the
what?
Table.
Sorry,
the camera
are
is
you,
under the table.
Are you trying to create your own urban legend if you stand in the bathroom and you say Dave's name three times, whip it out?
No, I just don't talk to people for weeks at a time. So I look in the mirror with my cock out.
Yep.
I'd say my name a whole bunch.
Oh, man, you stole the weird fact I was going
to
say.
I've forgotten how to talk to
people.
Oh, is it in there?
That was the weird fact right here.
Okay.
This one's kind of cool. Bruce Lee died from an allergic reaction to aspirin, but various Hong Kong news agencies reported other causes of death, including poisoning, a martial arts death touch, and murder by a secret organization.
Was he allergic to the aspirin?
I kind of wonder what this death touch is.
That's what's cool to me.
That's how Bruce Lee
how
died?
How do you do a death touch?
I don't know. Somewhere you can touch someone.
So like
and don't
something
they
around
faint
the neck?
You touch
you
them,
push it?
You touch them with
it,
a
is
with
it
a
meant
knife?
To be their temple?
What is it? The
like
5-point
that?
Exploding palm? What is it? The Kill Bill thing?
There's the 5-finger death thing. There's also
the exploding heart.
Yeah, there's also the Vulcan one. I don't know how that one works.
I don't do Star Trek. What is it? Yeah, 5-point palm exploding heart technique.
That's the one.
Thank you, Joey, for that.
Man.
Joey's over here filming.
Yeah,
Little
Joey.
Spark Films. Check them out on Facebook.
Joey. Little Spark Films. Yes. Shout out to Joey. Thank you, Little Spark Films. And also, man, before Tom gets away, a big thank you to Ziggy because he does a lot in this crowded room on video and audio. So thank you to our sound/video engineer, Ziggy.
Thank
oh, he's
you,
been
Ziggy.
Rocking it, man.
Yeah, yes. Thank you for not cutting off my mic.
You even broke a mic and he took care of you.
Okay.
Oh.
I played this game called I Try to Piss Ziggy Off and He Cuts My Mic.
You're cut off.
Okay, let's see here. I'm finishing up my drawing.
We used to call him the Great and Powerful Oz because he could
He might need a better pen over there.
Here, what's it going? No, this pen is absolutely fine.
All right.
So, can you look at that? Is it really 30? Like, I think I win. Mm-hmm. What do I get?
I love this.
I'm highly competitive.
Do. Rob, you're going to have to draw the.
So what made you guys decide to draw stick figures?
No talent.
Yeah, it wasn't so much a decision as a lack of options, because we can't draw very many things.
Well, it was kind of an evolution of what we were doing at the time.
That's
because
true.
We all met because we were interested in these stick figure flash animations that were going around during the turn of the millennium. And
the turn of the millennium.
Millennium. Yeah, could I get some reverb on that?
Hold on.
When flash websites ruled the internet.
We're going to capture that snippet.
Is this happening?
So, yeah, you might want to do it again. And more sing-song, please, Rob.
All right, ready?
Yeah.
The turn of the millennium, when flash cartoons ruled the web.
Oh.
Yes.
But, yeah, I mean, it was easy to make a stick figure move around. You know, it took no time for one person to do. And we were excited about just making cartoons all by ourselves. So that's how we met.
Yeah, there's a community
we
of teenage misfits called Newgrounds.com. It was the YouTube before YouTube. And
cool.
Like ever since the late 90s, people were posting cartoons up there, little flash animations. And we made these brutal, like, gory stick figure death animations for fun. Oh, wow, what is that?
What do you think?
Yeah. Okay, but remember the point is actually down.
Oh shoot! Well, you put
it's
it on the wrong
caricature.
Way.
It's a caricature.
I did.
It's a caricature.
Hold it like that
fix
for
it.
The rest of the show.
It's like a photograph.
But you guys do a great job of like drawing your characters' expressions on stick figures. They have so much personality.
Oh, thank you,
Dave Face.
It's all Dave Face.
I personally love your Space Invader shirt. That's one of my favorites.
Thank you.
Personal Space Invader.
You can buy it from our store for a fair price.
Yeah, cool.
Yeah, go get
stealing our store on the radio.
Get you a personal. Yeah, get a personal Space Invader shirt and a butt shark plushie.
Yep. Store.explosum.net.
Yes, buy now. Can we go to that, Ziggy?
Store.explosum.net.
Let's talk about your products because we love Joking Hazard, and I know you've got other merch, so. Heck yeah.
Joking Hazard is a great game to play with your family.
We have a thing
it's
called...
Wholesome, it's a good wholesome family game to play with your grandmother.
It really is. It is. There's the butt shark. Butt shark. See? And it can't catch yours for $22.99.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. We have F-bombs as well.
Yeah, you could drop an F-bomb.
That's right.
You can throw an F-bomb. These are office gifts.
I mean, if we had one right here,
you could get one for your dog.
Yes, very much like this.
Come on. Yes.
Oh, man. We should have brought one. They're good for throwing.
I seem to try catching it with my face every time you throw it.
We also have beer glasses, also good for throwing. You could throw those.
Wait, where are the beer? Okay, these?
Yeah, they have little drinking jokes on them. Okay, gotcha. So you can drink alone and go, that's
yeah,
funny.
Yeah, if you want
to. Okay, so. Hey.
It makes it less depressing.
Right.
Or if does you, it not make it
well,
less
you
depressing?
Know, I can't relate to a joke unless it's about drinking while I'm drinking. So
there you
I'm glad we bridged that gap.
But just for the record, is it store.explosum.net?
Or you can go to our website and click on store.
Yeah.
A lot
yeah,
of your comics do have to do with drinking.
It's true.
I like the one where he goes shopping and he buys all this alcohol. And the what is it?
That's
the cashier?
Chris Wilson, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I guess I really like Chris Wilson. I'm sorry, guys.
No, that's great.
No, I'm just kidding. I like all
he's
of them.
He's awesome. You should
I like all of
love
them.
Him.
He's the best.
No, he's great.
He's the most handsomest.
He is the handsomest.
And he has the biggest dick.
Yeah.
Who wrote your biographies on the back of your books?
I don't
it depends
even know.
On the book.
Which one?
I don't remember any of them. I just think they're funny. The first one, I guess.
I think the first one we did fake biographies that were made up.
And you also wrote like all the reviews are from your parents.
Oh yeah, that was the first one. Or, yeah, we said that
that's
Max's
right,
mom
yeah,
was dead and that kind of
and,
stuff.
And yeah, we
forgot what
we
your
talked
mom
about
said.
What our my mother said something about rap music and how I should turn it down. I think I don't remember. But by the depressing comic book, our profiles were essentially us bragging about how great our lives were. At the end of the book, where you're
oh, yeah.
to be crying.
Yeah, the depressing comic book ended with bios that were how amazing
yeah.
our lives were.
I really like the depressing comic book. It's really messed up because you're laughing at it and you're like, I shouldn't be laughing at
yeah.
this, but it's hilarious.
Depressing Comic Week is really satisfying for us too because
we get to search deep into our soul.
Well, there's, yeah, yeah,
pull out
it's
the
a
blank,
different process. We get to dig deep. And we also get to like bother and annoy a large mm-hmm. part of our fan base. Some of them stop reading us every week.
What?
Really?
Oh, can I touch on that subject for a moment? Please. And you don't have to talk about it if you don't want to, but I mean, maybe, I don't know, a couple of more interesting hate mails you've gotten or something.
You know, I can't think of hate mail that we've actually
gotten. It's been
gotten
a while.
Years,
okay.
You know?
All right.
I
fair
think
enough.
You get like the occasional
good.
Facebook message
we
just
got,
like, I'm not reading this anymore.
Yeah.
We touched upon one subject that really riled one guy up in 2007, 2008. But we were going to San Diego Comic Con that summer, and he said he was going to come and kill us. At San Diego Comic Convention.
Yeah. And then, of course, he didn't show up.
He didn't show up, so we wasted our time, really.
Did you guys get bodyguards? Did you have, like, bodyguards ready?
No, we were ready to die. We were ready for it. It would have been really good marketing, good press.
Yeah, absolutely. We would have been martyrs.
Martyrs of our own.
Martyrs.
They
should be talking about us today instead of not talking about us like they do now.
We would have seen a popularity spike in our comics, I think. But he didn't show up, obviously, because it's hard to get tickets for Comic-Con. I don't blame him.
I think his plan was foiled once he tried
to get
to the door.
Yeah. I'm sure he was outside the door fuming.
What is Comic-Con like? Because I've never been, but I have friends that have gone.
It's
crazy.
It's fucking crazy.
It's crazy. It's like a sardine can full of nerds. It's just wall-to-wall.
It stinks even more than a regular sardine can.
Have you seen people cosplay your, like,
not
characters?
Often. When I went to India for a Comic-Con, and there were a lot of CNH cosplayers. I was blown away by how many there were. But not as many here.
Were you implying that sweaty fans like to hug you and then...
happened
yeah,
multiple times.
There was one guy who would come to our... He came to our booth one year about 8 times dressed as
B Mario.
And this guy was huge. Huge and sweaty. And he was wearing a big costume.
He was at least 900 feet tall and wide. And he asked me to draw something for him, and his beads of sweat actually dripped onto the page as if it was raining as I was trying to draw something.
You had to improvise and draw around them and change what you were drawing.
Well, with all due respect, he had a costume on, right?
Mm-hmm.
So he was making an effort.
I mean, he was dressed as Mario.
Yeah,
that's
trying.
Two layers. You've got
that just made him sweatier. It made it worse for us.
Right. You've got your jumper. You've got your overalls. And you don't need to wear underwear at Comic-Con, right?
And he came back like 8 times. We were doing free sketches, and we tried to like gently encourage people to only get one. He kept coming around, getting more for his friends and family.
One more sketch.
I think eventually, so Dave, you snapped out of him and told him you couldn't do anymore.
Do you get serious hand cramp from doing that many sketches?
Yes. We usually do up to like 800 sketches at a con when we're all there together. And by the end of it, we have blisters on our fingers and cramps.
Blisters on my fingers. So you make me not want to go because...
Well, don't go as us. Don't go as a web celebrity comic heroes.
No,
that is the lamest thing you could have called us. Web celebrity comic hero.
If you go there as a fan, I'm sure you'll have a great time. But it's hard to sit behind the booth for 12 hours.
But how could you have so much fun if it is so freaking crowded?
We have fun. We have friends there who we only see at Comic-Con because they live in other cities, but like they do web comics with us.
Yeah, and it's always great to talk to the fans.
Yeah,
they're well-meaning.
Yeah, we didn't exactly sell them very highly just then with that story, but most of our fans.
We're talking about all the other nerds that are at Comic-Con. Yeah, definitely not our fans.
All the bad ones.
Okay. Yeah,
our fans are amazing.
And at the Banana Bar Crawl, you also draw cartoons.
At the Banana Bar Crawl, we've gotten into the habit of bringing Sharpies and then drawing on each other's costumes.
Yeah, I have like.
She has two or three penises on her back.
Three.
Oh, that wasn't us. Also, did we draw anything?
But what about
for you?
The drawings? Yeah.
Yeah, there was drawings. It just one just had a giant boner. That wasn't
like
on
us.
Me. That was on my brother. My brother had the giant boner one. Because he was like, What'd they draw? And I was like, you should look at this.
why do they draw it on the back and not the front? That's anatomically incorrect.
I don't know.
Yeah, obviously, we haven't studied the human body hard enough to be able to replicate it.
Because you always get frustrated with me about my costume because my costume's not like the normal.
What would happen
costume.
If you had a penis on your back, kind of like a tail?
That raises all kinds of questions.
That would be interesting because then that'd be really embarrassing if you got like an erection.
Yeah, you wouldn't know about
poking
it.
Poking from both ends.
I think it's proof that evolution is real.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. You got a tail back there.
Absolutely. Mother Evolution took a look at that and went, that's fucking stupid. Let's pull
I
that
I would
around.
Just run around and slap people with it. Like, shake my ass and slap people. And,
here's my question.
I would wag it like a dog.
Yeah. I'd back into people with it. Just like.
I mean, that's sexual assault. You have to be careful.
Yeah, you got to be careful.
Damn it.
And speaking of butthole entrances.
I don't know. I don't have experience.
Butthole entrances.
If there is a God, why did he make that just one parking space over from where you normally would insert something?
Slightly smaller. Oh, I thought you were literally talking about parking spaces. I was about to theorize on that for the next 2 hours. I don't know.
Yeah, it is weird that it's right next door. To some unpleasant areas.
I think, it's so you can carry your human like a bowling ball if you need to take them around.
Yeah. So is this back when giants ruled the world?
Well, yeah, absolutely. I mean, I can think of no other reason.
That would be so awkward.
Well, speaking of that, you know, the Ken Ham Museum.
Oh, yeah.
Do you have a story based on exactly what we were talking about right now?
In Kentucky or wherever it is. Yeah. You know, he built a big ark, which is a humongous thing. And he said this is a real replica. And that dinosaurs walked with man and various things. So,
sure.
So we have to just, warn our viewers and listeners that there is a science march coming up, but not that science. So he's got something called the Creation Science Museum.
And he is so convinced, too. He sits in an office and does documentaries about how dinosaurs and humans live together. And it's so obvious because the Bible is literal.
Isn't there a guy like outside Fort Worth who has a similar museum? And they actually present the Flintstones as, possible reality.
Yeah, well, there's
one historical in a Glen historical
Rose.
Nature.
Glen Rose, yeah. There's one there. That's the poor man's Ken Ham Museum. It's like one trailer with, I think, two artifacts in it. One of them is like a human footprint inside of a dinosaur footprint.
Right, right.
It's just impossible to fake. You could never.
There is a
never fake that.
No, you can't. No, no way. No harm. There's a fantastic museum in Dallas called the Perot Museum. I'm sure you've been.
Of course.
And I was walking into the dinosaur exhibit behind a father and son, and the father turned to the son and he said, "Son, this is the world's biggest lie."
What?
Why did he take him there?
Just to fill him full of disdain about how dinosaurs aren't real.
He should have taken him to Glen Rose and shown the footprint.
Yeah, yeah. It'd have been much more kid-friendly, I guess. Go on, son, put your foot in that foot.
Yeah.
Well, speaking of that, we do have a member in the burlesque troupe who works at the Perot Museum.
Great. Mm-hmm.
And I bet you might have bought something from her if you went into the bookshop there.
The gift shop. She works in the gift shop.
So, as a matter of fact, could we play that little Spark film, 2 minute, and it was on the stick, Ziggy. And that way you can kind of get a visual of the sideshow / neo-burlesque / all of our friends who work at the Perot Museum.
Please.
All of our friends who work at the Perot Museum.
Yeah, I like the segue.
Yeah, there we go. Cool.
deadly sins.
Oh boy.
Man, those are some deadly sins right there.
There you go. Mm-hmm. Next show is.
Wild chaos of deadly
sins.
Sweet, sweet.
That band was Responsible Johnny, and they're a fantastic punk band. They play in Deep Ellum all the time. They play a lot of places, so
cool.
You get the opportunity to check them out.
Sweet.
They're pretty fantastic.
And we're not afraid to throw hails to Satan.
And also, I want to just point out a reminder that Friday at Wits End, Scary Cherry and the Bang Bangs is playing.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Scary Cherry and the Bang Bangs.
Yeah.
Okay.
That one right there. Yeah.
Cool.
So at Wits
With
End.
The Bang Angels and the Guillotines.
Sweet. Mm-hmm. I'm going to take my mother.
You should. You should. What's you
in?
Should.
March 3rd. March 3rd.
Flyer in just for it.
So that's Friday night, right?
That is Friday night.
So
yeah.
then Saturday night, March 4th, is Lordy at Trees in Deep Ellum. Yep. So we'll see all the monsters.
And Marvel vs.
So it's a pretty
DC.
Exciting weekend for sort of monster themed metal.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Right. Fans. Metal and burlesque and burlesque. Sideshow and craziness.
If you like Marvel and DC, of course. Mm-hmm. If you're not a comic book fan, then I don't know if you're going to enjoy a burlesque show that's comic book themed.
Heck yeah.
Well, you know,
I think you have to be a comic book fan these days or you'll get, you know, beat up in the streets.
And a lot of comics are in burlesque.
Lots of comic nerds running around sort of grabbing you by their shirt and going.
Comic books
are you a comic
and video
book
games,
fan?
They make a lot of appearances and routines.
Yeah.
And also childhood cartoons.
Mm-hmm. Like what?
My friend Rain did Winnie the Pooh. She did Tigger and stuck a dildo up Winnie
the Pooh's
ass.
I was going to ask about, okay.
Yeah.
What about a pup named Scooby-Doo? Cool. Remember that?
I don't think anybody's done a pup named Scooby-Doo.
Burlesque.
That'd be interesting.
I want to see some Voltron where all these ladies connect together and form a giant lady.
I'm working on Rock'em Sock'em Robots.
That would be awesome.
I'm working on that. I have a friend that makes this amazing balloon art. He's going to make me like a whole balloon costume.
Cool.
So he makes balloon caricatures. Like he makes caricatures of people out of like balloons.
That's really cool. I never heard of that.
That's pretty awesome.
How does that even work? Like,
it's crazy. He also blows them up with his mouth. Like he doesn't use a pump. He's just like, and then he's like twist, twist, twist.
So how
twist.
Big are the caricatures? Faces. Are
they're
they
like
huge or
this
like
big?
Cool.
He also made me a parasol of dicks.
Yep. That sounds like something you could probably search for on the internet quite easily.
Yeah. I had a picture somewhere. But it has like a dick for a base, and then it has like the balloons, or it's a parasol. It's made of balloons. And then he put like little dicks hanging from each spoke of the parasol.
Wow, so it's like fractal dicks.
Fractal, yeah.
That's amazing.
So
does it protect you,
like,
you from
would
the
take
sun?
It and you could smack people in the face with it. You could, like, spin it. So I was standing close to everybody here and spinning it, and it was like,
yeah,
smack,
but then,
smack,
yeah.
Smack,
I mean,
smack,
first
smack.
Of all, you have to encourage someone to stand in front of the parasol of dicks so you can spin it. And that takes a lot of encouragement.
No, I really, it's like, hey, just stand right here.
I feel
it's like I'm definitely not going to spin the parasol of dicks in your face.
No, just say, come look at this. Look at how amazing this is. Get real close.
I think parasol dicks disprove evolution, to be honest.
It does.
He also made me a hula hoop.
Only God could design that.
Dicks.
I imagine, like, you know those frilled dragons that go like that? I imagine they have parasol dicks. Like, they do that with their dicks as well.
Yeah. I would back off if I saw that.
He made me a hula hoop of dicks out of balloons.
What I'm thinking is that next time you guys come on our show, we'll also invite Austin, the balloon guy.
Please.
Yeah, that'd be awesome.
He sat here when we had him a few months back, but he made a whole bunch of creations just during the show. It was awesome.
Yeah, he can make caricatures of you guys.
That'd be awesome.
Cool. Out of dicks.
Yeah, with a dick.
We still got a little time, but I didn't want it to get away from us before we actually all strike the black metal pose.
Please.
Which pose is this?
Can't do it.
I hope we got that captured, and we might...
When we're talking black metal, are we talking like the little twiggy boys in the forest going, yeah, the bear.
Well,
yeah.
I don't call them the twiggy boys, but yes.
They're a bit twiggy because they like to hang around trees.
Do you think they pick their names by, like, putting a pile of sticks together and being like, that looks like something.
Yeah, a logo.
Yeah.
That's Satan. How I write my comics. So I just throw sticks on the ground.
Sticks on the ground and be like, that looks like, that's, yeah.
That one's funny.
Yeah, it's not very contemporary. I mean, people have been doing it that way for hundreds of years.
What have you got pulled up, Ziggy? Is it another short?
Ooh, this is one of my favorites.
Oh good. Shoot. Yeah, let's do it.
Let's rock.
Yeah.
Good evening, sir and madam. Welcome to La Telepathie. Have you dined with us before?
No, this is our first time.
We've heard great things.
The great things you've heard, madam, are quite correct.
So can we see the menu?
There are no menus, I'm afraid.
Are there any specials tonight?
Every dish is special, sir. You see, each meal is tailored to the innermost cravings of each specific diner. Our chefs monitor each customer's brain activity and create a culinary masterpiece based on their individual wishes.
That's fantastic. So how do we order?
No need to order, sir. Your minds have already informed our chef of the dish you desire.
This is amazing. I wonder what we're gonna get.
I'm so excited. I hope mine's made of chocolate, or bacon, or caviar.
Me too. I can't wait to find out. Happy anniversary, sweetheart.
Your chocolate caviar fountain with bacon crackers, madam.
This looks amazing!
And for you, sir, your dicks.
What in fuck's name is that?
Your dinner, sir. Dicks.
There must be some kind of mistake. I don't...
Steven, why did he bring you dicks?
I don't know. This is not what I ordered.
Sir, you were telepathically monitored, and this is most certainly the dish that your brain desired.
My brain didn't desire this.
We are a respectable establishment and can assure you that your brain specifically said... Ooh, I hope I get a big pile of dicks to put in my mouth. That would be so yummy-wummy. Sir.
Well, I don't want it. This is a mix-up.
Steven, you're making a scene.
We cannot just replace the dicks you ordered because you changed your mind.
Send it back and bring me something else right now.
You're ruining our anniversary. I'm leaving. Have fun with your plate of dicks.
I'll get your check, sir.
Oh my god, that's so fucking good.
So, Dave, obviously that was you.
It keeps going.
Okay.
There we go. That kind of fits in with our theme of parasol dicks and stuff like that.
Yeah, it does. It does.
Yeah,
I'm all the dicks.
I played the waiter. That was written by Evan Peterson and Chris Wilson. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I was very fortunate to get to voice the waiter.
I had part in this one.
Yes,
that's great.
But I
wasn't involved in this one, but I did have. Well, actually, I was. I had the idea of that one shot where he gets really close and goes "dicks," and then he pulls back really fast. That was my only influence.
We cannot just replace the dicks.
Yeah.
But on Beer Run, you did some of the voices, right, Rob?
Yeah, I was the guy coming out of the grocery store with the shopping cart full of food.
The guy with his head kind of like that.
Yeah.
What were you talking about?
And then she was like, "I don't even eat pasta," and I was like, yeah, "I don't know,
get out
I don't know why."
But are the rest of the voices professional voice actor?
It's mostly us.
It's mostly us.
Okay.
It's us and the people who work in our studio and some of our friends.
Okay. If you need extras, you know, background or anything, you know,
yeah, that would be awesome.
You know, if you need some weird metalhead,
sure.
Weird metalhead. I'll wear the stilts in the costume. I don't know.
It won't come through in the audio, but it's good. It's good for, yeah. good for the character.
Inspire the crew.
He sounds so tall and Satan-like.
Yeah, exactly. How tall is that guy? Listen to his voice.
Walking around as a 12-foot Satan in Deep Ellum sometimes, so we're all over, West End, other places.
Sure.
I do get comments from occasionally religious fanatics.
I have seen people stop and bow down to him.
Wag their finger at me for being Satan, and others who just love it.
I've seen more people like stop and bow down to you than wag their finger. I also saw a girl pull her boob out.
Whoa.
Yeah. Oh, wow.
Yeah, that was interesting. You didn't know what to do. You're just staring at her.
I love that being her first thought. Oh, and Satan's here.
Like,
it's time to.
She's got one boob out, and she's just looking up at him, and he's like, well, that's nice.
She was tempting you. There was no way you were going to get done.
How do you tempt Satan? Like, what kind of person are you?
Really weird.
It's like, how do you?
You just like walk.
How do you
faster?
Like it, Beach?
It's sort of like when these religious nuts say, "And that's an insult to God." And I'm thinking to myself, if he's all powerful, certainly nothing we do is going to insult him.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Well, I don't know.
Also, why doesn't God come down and tell me to my face?
Like, yes.
Also, I would have thought that if you're dressing up as Satan, God would be like, well, you're kind of making fun of him. You're making fun of Satan. Good job. In fact, come on into heaven right now.
And then he kills you.
And then he kills you, I guess.
But that other article that Hemant was referring to is, you know, they had this actual panel at CPAC, this conference that was last week, and, you know, about the fact that since there's a gate in heaven, well, you know, his point was, why is there a gate with a gatekeeper? You know, why is that? Why is there a gate there? You know,
you think they'd upgrade?
Yeah,
like, you know, like a nice glass panel door.
It's because what people know what to look for, you know, so they don't get lost.
If you're going up,
you gotta have a gate.
Because that's how ghosts happen, right? They get a little lost, and then they go back home and just sit there for a while.
I am so directionally challenged. I'm totally going to be a ghost.
I support the ones who fall and then rip up the other, you know, the other angels.
And have 25 missing.
Look at all the guts here.
I found 30.
It's set in Hollywood. I noticed the second one. What deeper meaning is there behind?
Oh, that's what's happening right now at the Oscars.
Right, this is the Oscars. Yeah,
we're missing it. Dang.
Some people are watching this instead of the Oscars.
I just appreciate that they're clearly Star Wars fans.
Any other comments in the
like
chat room?
Like you said, there's a TIE fighter.
The demon with the wings here represents La La Land ripping apart every other movie and winning all the Oscars.
Yes.
I forgot the Oscars were even on tonight.
Yeah.
What people forget is that the golden age of Satan in the movies was like in the 70s.
Mm-hmm. You mean with like The Exorcist and stuff like that?
Right. Damien and, and such.
The Omen? You mean The Omen?
I'm sorry, The Omen.
Yeah.
Were evil kids? Like all the evil children
Rosemary's
movies?
Rosemary's Baby?
Yeah, no. Yep. No.
Satan's
evil children.
Cheerleaders. Was that in the 70s?
Probably was.
It was 1977. A masterpiece of cinema.
Yeah, well, speaking of master, I did masturbate to it.
Wow. Perfect. Okay. Yes.
Because the cheerleader.
Is it still in here? Did you masturbate?
It's all over that dude.
I wouldn't touch that box.
Oh, gross.
Yeah, you did.
Yeah, no, wait. I'm sure it smells funny in there, yes. Oh, well. But, and then I think Ty West brought it back with this slow burn. And then yesterday, the brand new movie from Jordan Peele, we got to give a shout out again. Encourage you guys to check it out, man, is Get Out.
Yes.
Yes.
Oh, wow. It's on my list. I'm going to see it right away.
Mm-hmm. It'll make you uncomfortable, which you want in a horror movie. Mm-hmm. And it'll make you rethink what it's like to be a white guy in this country.
Sure. No, absolutely. I can understand that. I'm sure it'll pose a lot of questions.
I don't know. Go ahead. What were you going to?
Nothing.
Yeah.
I was going to say, also, don't forget that that all-women horror movie XX is out, too. So check that one out, too.
Okay.
I haven't heard of that one.
It's an anthology, four women directors. And it's pretty... insane.
But, oh, it's kind of like VHS in that.
Yeah, it's kind of like VHS, but it's all directed by women. And the main characters in all the movies are women.
Awesome. And one of them is Annie Clark.
Right.
Yeah.
St. Vincent.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, she did one. Hers was the weirdest one.
Yeah, she did a short.
It was about a birthday party. Right.
Yeah. Cool. Okay.
Yeah.
Sweet.
Yeah, got it. So Ziggy's saying we got to wrap it up. And so we want to give a shout out, of course, to Janie / thank you, to Joey Little Spark Films, to CNH, CYANIDE and Happiness, Rob and Dave. Thank you,
yes,
guys.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you for having us here.
And of course, our, who am I forgetting who?
Ziggy?
And also our artist who did our logo. And
Voodoo Magic Designs. Yes.
Don't forget, there's a banana bar crawl happening, Deep Ellum, March 25th.
Yes.
Yeah, right. Come and get, make it.
Just look like
come
a banana.
Get with us.
Get drunk. Conga.
If it ever happened on actual St. Patrick's Day, wouldn't that be a mega party?
Whoa.
Banana bar crawl.
That would be like two storms colliding.
Yes, it would. The perfect two storms.
It would be absolutely wonderful. But, we might confuse people. They're deciding whether to dress up as a leprechaun or banana.
Right,
I don't know if we get some sort of cosplay mix up.
Like
two.
Green.
You just
yellow.
Get green bananas. Yeah. You would get just a not
plantain.
Right.
So you'd get a weird fruit roll-up flavor.
But Voodoo Magic Designs did our intro, outro, and our logo, yes. And a big shout-out to
remember
them.
Remember Scary Cherry on Friday at Wits End and Lordy on Saturday.
Yes.
Hell
yes,
yeah.
And Marvel vs. DC.
Thank you, guys.
Thank
Thanks
you.
So much.
Thank
Thanks
you.
So much.
Thank you. Have a
Thank
good week.
Thank you, Ziggy. Yep. You can do it. I want you guys to check this out. Get it on. Get it on. Get it on. Get it on.